If you would be willing to move to the front half of the room, that would be great. Let me just conduct a little business before I get into my presentation. I'm Steve Hauer. I'm a recently retired pastor of a congregation in St. Louis. It was St. John's for the time that I was there, typically in Ellisville. It's now called Pathfinder, and God really blessed that work. I'm now doing some other things. I have a radio broadcast that's heard every Sunday in the greater St. Louis area at 9 a.m. and a repeat broadcast at 6 p.m. I've also written a number of books, and I just want to get that out of the way. They're up here. I have a website called howerbooks.com. Hard to forget, easy to remember, howerbooks.com. And they sell on that site. They sell on Amazon for $19, and you get free shipping. They sell on my site for $17, and you get free shipping. But because you're at the conference, I'm going to pretty much give them away. So $10 a book if you want one. There's Man in the Middle, which is my most recent book, which is what I'm going to be talking about today. That's a tenuous place to be in the middle, isn't it? To speak the truth in love, to speak the truth, but also speak love. You know, both sides want to draw you to one extreme or the other. To live in the middle is a tough place to be. It got John the Baptist beheaded and it got Jesus crucified. But that's where God asks us to be, speak the truth in love. That's what this book is about. It's a take on the issues of our day. The subtitle is called Discerning Right and Wrong in a Culture That's Lost Its Way. And I think we would say maybe it lost its mind. There's another book here. This is the first book I ever wrote called Sharpening the Sword, which is a study of 50 famous leaders. You probably would recognize all of them with biblical applications. So if you want a book that will give you good topical material that you can just, you know, use and not quote me, feel free to do that. We've all done it. And there's another book here. They just threw some in a box and sent them here. This is Serenity Principles, based on the Serenity Prayer. You know, God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the wisdom to change the things I can, and the courage to know the difference, or something like that. And this is about how you can break through. I've always been amazed as a pastor how many people are paralyzed by a setback in their life. Could be a tragic loss of a child, could be a divorce, could be loss of a job. You know, doesn't God's word have the power to help us move forward? And so this came out of that kind of experience with all of my people for many years. Serenity Principles, how to break through from whatever's holding you back. And this is called Contrary to Popular Belief. It's a study of 25 things that that the culture doesn't understand about us, that thinks we're crazy because we believe these things. You know, was Jesus a good man or was he a God man? You know, things that just don't make any sense that Christians believe. 25 articles about that. So they're all up here. If you need change, there's an envelope here that has some money in it. I'll just trust you. Maybe somebody can help do that if I'm talking to people after the presentation. Just help. And there's some cards laid out on the stage if you want to pick one up. It has all of my contact information in it if you'd like to contact me later, if you'd like me to come to your place and speak. I'm speaking here this morning. I'm speaking to a couple of men's groups this afternoon somewhere else in the city, and then I'm speaking tomorrow at Scott Seidler's ministry over at Desert, Shepherd of the Desert, I think, Lutheran church in town. So I think I've covered everything. Questions and answers in just a minute, but let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, tough topic today to talk about standing in the middle, speaking your truth, but doing it in a compassionate, loving, understanding, and gracious way. It's a hard place to be, Lord. And both sides want to draw us to their extreme. But Lord, we want to be what you want us to be. We're people of meager ability. But when you come alongside and when you bless our words, our truth, we know that nothing is impossible with you. And so, Lord, I ask you to be in this place. I ask you to give power to my words and help me just be good counsel to these folks as they think these things out loud with me. And help me also to be perceptive and open and gracious and listening and learning even as I speak. Lord, we just ask all this because we know that you have promised to be with us. We know that because of Jesus, you have made us your child. And we expect a father's gracious and loving care. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So So welcome again if you came in late. I'm Steve Hauer. Privileged to be with you today. And we're going to be talking about that fine line between truth and love. So let me just start out here in the group. I know this guy. I'm Steve, and you're Todd. And Todd, if you would just answer a simple question for me. Were you raised in the Christian faith?
No, sir.
No, you weren't. So how did you become a Christian then?
I became a Christian because of a beer-drinking fraternity in college.
So that was a topic for an evening, or was this just a personal friend encounter? How did that happen?
I won't bore you with the details, but this college I went to, they forced everyone to go to chapel, and the actives of the fraternity said, Todd, we're not going to go, and you got to figure out how to sign us in so I don't have to go. And I went to chapel for 18 weeks. And
signed in all those people?
I did. And I thought, hey, I think I believe this stuff.
Okay, I know you're a married man because Todd and I worked together for a number of years, and I knew that you weren't raised in the Christian faith, and I know that you've overcome a lot of personal issues in your life. Your wife, you're a married person. Was she raised in the Christian faith?
Pastor's kid.
A pastor's kid. Nope. So the question still stands. Was she raised in the Christian faith?
Yes.
Okay, all right, we'll leave it there. Thanks, Todd. Hi, I'm Steve.
Hi,
Mary. Mary, do you believe in self-evident truth? You know, the Declaration of Independence says we hold these truths to be what? Self-evident, that all people are created equal and that they're endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Do you believe in self-evident truth?
I do.
You do. So you think that the country could be formed in the same way today just because this is what every people know to be true. You know, it's just obvious that although they don't believe in Jesus, they do believe that there's right and wrong.
For me, it's what works for, it's through Christ and what I have based my life upon that needs to be incorporated in self-evident truth.
Okay. And so when you talk to other people, you have a leg up because if you believe in self-evident truth, then you have a sense that what you say, they also know is true.
Well, I don't, actually.
Yeah.
So you don't think it's self-evident to them necessarily, even though it is to you?
Not until we get to know each other.
Okay.
Thank you, Mary. Appreciate it. Hi, I'm Steve. Don, good to meet you as well. Don, what should America do about the abortion issue?
I'm passing on that one.
You're going to pass it? You're not going to touch that? You're not going to touch that?
If there's anything I would say, it needs to continue to dialogue and figure out how we do it as a country and how then we as Christian people respond to that.
So do you have a personal faith, a personal belief that impacts that question, you think?
I absolutely do.
You absolutely do. But to come in strong with that position would not be helpful, you believe?
I don't think I said that, did I?
I don't know. I'm clarifying. You know, this is called active listening, where you ask questions to clarify.
Some of these questions are a little personal. They get right at it.
Yeah.
So when you say come in strong, who are you talking about?
I'm saying, you know, let your position be known when you're engaging somebody in a conversation about that issue.
Absolutely. It's different than necessarily marching on the street or standing in front of a place or writing stuff. In a conversation with somebody, I'm more than glad to do that. In other places, I may be a little bit different because of the audience and my role.
Okay, Don, thank you for your time. I appreciate it. See, somebody has convinced Christians that there's two things that you don't talk about in this world. And that's what? Yeah, faith and politics, or I would even say faith and culture. There's so many things in the culture that we know, like abortion, political or not, sometimes political, sometimes not, that we just don't touch because people have strong opinions about these things. And so we don't talk about them. And we don't talk about our faith. So how's anybody going to come to faith? See, I think you could have these conversations, as I just did, with people. And I don't claim to be an expert at this. I don't even claim that I did this for the most of my ministry. I think I was like most. I think I avoided issues that I know would be controversial. But, you know, I'm retired now, and nobody can fire me, so. But I do have a lot of personal relationships. I'm a golfer, and I won't bore you with the details, but we rehabbed a lot of houses while I was in ministry, and so I was able to buy a house in the panhandle of Florida. I still have a villa in St. Louis where we have family. So I split time between. And in both places, I have guys that have become good friends that I golf with. And, man, they are all over the map on these issues. One of my best friends in Florida is an extremely liberal dude from Illinois, up around the Chicago area. And his politics and mine are quite different, but we're great friends. And so you talk mostly about golf out there. In fact, I've even played golf in St. Louis with a rabbi who's become a good friend too, Mark Schenck. And I just love to ask questions. And you know what happens when you ask questions? They get a little tense about the questions, and they begin to ask you questions. And so then you're answering their questions. You're not promoting your point of view. You're just answering the questions that they're going to put back on you. You can dialogue about these things without being offensive, but somebody's convinced us that we don't talk about these things. Now, the guys I golf with in Florida and also the guys I golf with in St. Louis have moved from talking about golf and talking about politics to talking about faith, because when we finish the round, we sit down for a beer, and whoever had the most birdies that day has to buy. I try to avoid that, so... I'm sometimes successful. And it's interesting. And now what they want to do is they want to get the wives together and go out for dinner. And so we've moved a hobby to a faith discussion between us, to a discussion about family and children. And the liberal guy I was talking about is just fascinating because he intimidated me at first. You know, he's very educated. He was a CEO, strong guy. And strong in his opinions about things. We both want the same things. You know, he wants people to have a good life. He wants them to be blessed. We believe differently about how you get there. But it's interesting how he's begun to ask me. In fact, we had a conversation recently, and it was on an issue like this, and he says, he read my book, Man in the Middle, which is where I think we live as Christians. And so he's begun to ask me a lot of questions now. And I'm always a little defensive, like, you know, he's taking me somewhere, he's going to drop the hammer in a minute. But he said, Steve, I just want to know. He's a seeker. He was raised Catholic, but he got upset with all the abuse issues in the Catholic Church, and so he doesn't go to church anymore, anywhere. But he still has that inside him. He still believes, Mary, in self-evident truth. And he's trying to figure it out. And if we aren't there to grant answers for them, who will help them? You know, unless somebody tells them. And that's your job, like it or not. It's not an easy place to be. As I said, there are people that are going to pull you in both extremes. There's a true story, and I'm telling this story for you, Todd, because it's a historic story, and you know that I used a lot of historic examples in my ministry. I just love true stories. I don't think you need to make up a lot of stories. There's enough truth in the world. And it's about Douglas MacArthur. And, of course, he was involved in World War II, but really came to prominence in the Korean War, right? 1950, 1953, and was famously removed from his position because he didn't believe, you know, just securing South Korea was enough. He attacked North Korea, which involved the Chinese, which caused him to lose his job. But he had done an incredible thing in South Korea and was considered a military genius by the way he took back and secured South Korea from the North Korean invasion. And he liked to visit the front lines. You know, he was a military guy. And one time he was out on the front lines, and all of his junior officers urged him not to go there. It's dangerous there. You know, you shouldn't be there. But he said, no, the men need to see their leader. And I should be willing to do anything that they do, put myself in harm's way, you know, to encourage them, be an example to them. And so he went out, and sure enough, he was on the front lines, and bullets began whipping in, you know, from somewhere, zinging around him. And he dove into a bunker with some other people, and he grabbed a grizzled staff sergeant, and he said, put a squad together, find that sniper, and take him out. He says, sir, we don't need to do that. He goes, what do you mean you don't need to do that? He said, we know exactly where he is, and we know who he is, and we can take him out anytime we want. But he is such a poor shot that if we took him out, the Koreans might actually put a good shooter in there, and then we'd be in real trouble. You know, why take out somebody that's ineffective? There's just too many ineffective Christians. There's too many Christians that lack the courage of their convictions. So why bother? You know, they're not going to upset anything. They're not going to put themselves in harm's way. Because it hurts. You know, I'd prefer to be in this group. I'd prefer to be in that group. I hate being in the middle. It's a painful place to be. But that's what we're called to be. We don't get to choose. I saw a New York Post article the other day. And here was the title of the Post article, the New York Post article. It said, Christian bells are no longer ringing, they're tolling. You know the difference between church bells when they ring and church bells when they toll? They don't do that much anymore. They don't toll much anymore. But in Europe, back in the day, they tolled. And in fact, where I did my field work in a farm town in central Illinois, they still tolled the bells there. Lou Cokey was the pastor. It was Mount Pulaski, Illinois. I went to school at Springfield. And so I was doing my field work up there. And if somebody died in the congregation, they would toll the bell once if it was a man, twice if it was a woman, three times if it was a child, and then they would toll the number of years of that person's life. And so that's why the poem says, don't ask for whom the bell tolls. You know, people would stop. You could hear that Mount Pulaski is called Mount Pulaski because central Illinois is flat. But Mount Pulaski was built on a bit of a hill. And no matter where you were, within 2 miles of that place, you could hear that bell. And they would wonder, who does the bell toll for? In that Post article, they were talking about the fact that the church bells are tolling for the death of the church. They're not ringing anymore. They're tolling for the death of the church. Death by suicide, I would say. For the first time in America's history, this past year, the number of people who identified an affiliation with a Christian church, a Jewish synagogue, or a Muslim mosque, all three of those, church, synagogue, or mosque, fell below 50%. The number of people who identified, I'm not even talking about went to church, I'm just talking about said, you know, I'm a Christian. Most people would say that. Today, they don't say that. For 70 years, was around, or for 60 years, it was 50%. In the last 10 years, it's dropped to 47%. For six decades, it was 70%. Now, it's not a thing anymore, and people have begun to doubt. Because I think somebody has convinced us that we are no longer to be the salt of the earth. We are no longer to be a light on a hill. And so we hide our light. And if salt has lost its saltiness, what does the Bible say? It's useless. It's like sand. You know, it doesn't serve its purpose anymore. You know, like it or not, folks, that's what we're called to be. In the last 10 years, and I'm sure COVID had a lot to do with this too, but I think not merely COVID, because usually hard times are good times for faith. But in the last 10 years, the number of people who declared they had no religious belief, and this is based on a Barna poll, I mean, basically a Christian polling group. 10 years ago, there were 8% of Americans who said we have no religious basis, no religious belief, no belief in God. Agnostic at best, perhaps, you know, some belief in God, but no God in particular. It's now 21% of Americans. Barna, 21% of Americans. Say they have no religious belief. This is where you live. This is what you do. This is, you know, where you encourage other people. If you're here, you're a leader of some sort. You have a sphere of influence, and it's important for you to know this. And among millennials, people in their 20s and 30s, 48% say they have no religious belief, not sure about anything divine. Incredible, huh? That's the direction of the country. Now, I don't think we should know that, but we should not fear that. That's just job security. That's just opportunity waiting. But you got to know that wherever you go and whoever you talk to, there's opportunity for you to share the faith. What's the worst that could happen? They're probably not going to behead you. They're probably not going to crucify you. They may shun you for a bit. But if you do it graciously, and you have to do both of these things, you have to be gracious, but you have to also be willing to forthtell. You have to be willing to tell the truth. If you do it graciously, they'll be like my golf buddies, I think. They will respect you, even if, like the rabbi says, Steve, we're on the golf course, we're not talking church here. And that's okay. And I said, well, why does that bother you? And so, you know, just don't let them off, you know. I think these are important things. I think we can talk about these things. We should talk about significant things in life, and these are the most significant things. We all know the Great Commission, don't we? Matthew 28. Jesus said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, this is my declaration for you. Go and make disciples of all people. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what? Teach them to observe some of the things that I've told you. The easy things I've told you, right? No, he said all the things. Teach them everything I have commanded you. And no, you're not going to do this alone. I will be with you always until the end of the earth. It was hard for me to be here today. You know, I prefer to choose a topic that would be about how you deal with other people instead of talking about how you deal with yourself. That would be easier for me. But I'm not here because it's easy. I'm here because the conference is paying me $2,000 to be here today. And a crown in heaven. So that's what God has asked us to do. And he's promised that he will be with us always till the end of the age. Now, that's the Great Commission for all people. That's what we're to encourage our congregations, you know, our Christian friends, you know, that's what we're to do personally, not just professionally. Now, the marching orders for Christian leaders are found elsewhere in the Bible. I think Ephesians 4 is probably the best place to look for that. In Ephesians 4, Paul told the church at Ephesus, Christ himself has given all kinds of leaders, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, you fall into one of those categories, to equip the people so that they can do the work. You know, we're to multiply ourselves. You know, find 12 guys, find 12 women, find 12 people. They can be fishermen. They can be tax collectors. They can be whoever. They don't have to be other professional people. Find 12 people and multiply yourself. Equip people to do the works of service. So that the body of Christ may be built up until we reach unity in the faith. That's a constant work. In the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. You know, Jesus came. I love John's description of the Christmas story. You know, the light came into the world. You know, he was not the Savior. He was a witness to the Savior. John came bearing witness to the light. Then Jesus came. The law was given through Moses, but what does it say? Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Grace and truth. Speaking truth, love. Grace, truth, grace. God's riches at Christ's expense, and yet also truth. So he says, we are no longer to be infants. We're no longer to be driven and tossed like the waves are, driven and tossed by every whim of the culture. And man, the culture is whipping people around today. We're not to be among them. We know the truth. You know, we have the truth. Not driven and tossed by every teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up and become, in every respect, the mature body of him who is our head, namely Christ. From him, the whole body is joined together, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. That's a fine line to walk, to speak the truth in love, to walk the line between grace and truth. And I would say also Jesus, not only in his birth does it say he came with grace and truth, it also says in his death, as he gathered his 12 disciples together in the upper room, Last Supper, high priestly prayer, John 17. You know that prayer, incredible prayer. Father, And don't ask that you take them out of the world. Doggone it, I wish we could. I wish we could all go to monasteries and, you know, just navel gaze and, you know, just sing Kumbaya in our churches. You know, they're given to be in the world. But protect them, Lord. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. You know, that's the only way to keep them secure in the truth. Because they're in the world, and the world will hate them because, like me, they're not in the world. They cannot just agree with the world. It seems simple, but it's not. To speak the truth in love, to walk the middle. There will always be people who are truth tellers, who don't care, who aren't compassionate, who just bang on people with the word of God. And, you know, we don't want to be those people. Some wise person said to me years ago, there's always somebody on your side that you wish were fighting for the enemy. I know Christian leaders like that, and they get up and just bang away, and I don't disagree with what they say, but I disagree with the way they say it. You know, they're just beating people down. You know, truth that has no love is never heard. It's impotent. But love without truth is not true love. You're avoiding things. The Bible says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses or the encouragement of an enemy. You know, the enemy doesn't care. You know, I'll just tell you what you want to hear. But deceitful are the, but faithful are the wounds of a friend. That's where we must live. But there are always truth tellers. There were legalists in Jesus' day. There were legalists in Paul's day. Jesus said about them, they tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and they put them on other people's shoulders, Matthew 23. They themselves can't even carry them. You can't carry that kind of faith. You know, I always say there's only two faiths in the world. There are those that teach you what you must do to please God. That's every other faith in the world. And then there's a Christian faith that teaches what God has done to make you pleasing. Huge difference. Not what you do, it's what God has done for you. Then he says, woe to you, teachers of the law, people who bang on other people. You're hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup, you know, you look like you got it all together. You know, this is the way we ought to be. But inside, you have sin to deal with yourself. Greed and selfish indulgence. Blind Pharisees, first clean the inside of your cup. Admit that you are also a sinner in need. And then wash up also the outside. So there's that side that pulls at you, the legalist. You know, when I was young, younger, I just read, coming down here, I read a Golf Digest article. It was an interview of Clint Eastwood. And one of his famous things in that interview was, never let the old man inside. You know, how old would you be if you didn't know how old you are? But when I was younger, getting off the track, when I was younger, the battle for the Bible was going on. And I had gone to Austin, Texas, to Concordia, Austin, Texas. I got to tell you, I didn't grow up the son of a pastor, son of a teacher. My dad was a World War II vet. He worked at International Harvester on the assembly line. He was an alcoholic. He died young. Two of my younger brothers followed him into alcohol, and they also never reached their 50th birthday. Sad thing. He was a provider. He wasn't an abuser. But, man, he had his struggle. And so I found other people in my life, like Todd did, you know, who were and had a similar experience with parenting. Found other people who spoke the truth in love to me and brought me out. And so then I go to Concordia Austin, and the battle for the Bible was going on, and that was when higher criticism was, you know, ablaze, you know, in our denomination. Some of you are too young to even know what that means, but believe me, it was a group of people who believed that there were sources that the Bible was based on, JEDP. In fact, I kept the book I had in school there in my theology classes called People of the Covenant, which taught that stuff, and, you know, the higher critical method. And I thought, wow, I never knew this. I thought the Bible was true. But now I realize that there are influences that the people who wrote the Bible fell under, and so they were students of their own time, they were people of their own culture, and then there's also truth, and we have to ferret it out. We have to figure out what's true and what's not true. And I remember I went home. There's a point to this in a minute. I remember I went home, and my church back in the day was doing the Kennedy Evangelism Explosion, where you'd go out, you know, and make visits in the neighborhood, and you would ask a couple of questions, you know, if after polite conversation. I like it because, you know, it told Christians you should not be silent, and it kind of taught us how to go about that and do that. So there was good to it. I always think people who are manipulated and convinced against their will are never really converted anyway. And so I came to believe that that wasn't necessarily the best way to do it. But Dwight Moody once asked people who were against pulpit and altar calls, Lutherans actually challenged him on that and said, you know, that's a wrong thing, you know, because people tend to believe on the decision they made rather than on the grace of God. And Moody said, well, how do you do it? And he said, well, we haven't quite figured it out yet. And he said, well, I like the way I do it better that's wrong than the way you don't do it at all. And so there's something to be said for that, you know. And so I was out one night making visits with a layman. He was not the sharpest knife in the drawer. I could tell you his name because I could see him in my mind, but I don't even know if he's still alive because he was quite a bit older than me. I was just a student at the time. So I was, no one was home that night. And so we were having this conversation in the car, as you do when you go out and make calls and you have somebody else in the car with you. So I was telling him, I was telling this ignorant guy about all the wonderful things I was learning about, you know, how the Bible isn't exactly true. It isn't exactly inerrant. It isn't exactly inspired. It isn't exactly efficacious. You know, we have to ferret it out. We have to figure it out. We have to be students who examine the Bible. When I got done with my brilliant expose on higher criticism, Bob just looked at me, simple guy that he was, and he says, somehow, Steve, that just doesn't seem right to me. And Bob knew and I knew that he was right and I was wrong that quickly. Truth has an edge to it. Truth has an edge to it. And we, you know, Mary again, self-evident truth. It rang true. He didn't have the Bible verses to quote. He didn't have probably the intelligence to argue with this intelligent, you know, straight-A guy that was coming out of college. But he was right and I was wrong. And I knew it immediately. And he did too. And it forever changed me. And so I thought, well, now I got to go to the seminary. Where do I go to the seminary? Because at the time, all of my buddies and all of my upperclassmen were going to Seminacs where it was being taught. I don't believe that everybody there was teaching that. I believe that some were just sympathetic to the people who were there because they were being strong-armed. And the administration at the time was just firing people right and left. So I just want to say that I don't believe that everybody who was in that camp necessarily was a defender of those things. It took me a little while to learn that. You tend to be judgmental when you're young. But I thought, I like the people who speak the truth, but man, they can be mean. You know, they can be abusive of others. And I like the people who favor the higher critical method because they're gracious, they're kind, and a lot of my friends were there. I thought, wow, this is a tough place to be. Can't we be people of the Bible? Can't we be conservative and also gracious? Isn't it possible to speak the truth in love? And so even back then, I was kind of always a man without a church, you know, a man in the middle. And so there are those people who thump at you, and you say, it doesn't seem right. You know, I tend to agree. Everything they say about abortion is true, but the way they say it is, it's not effective. It's not helpful. Truth without love is never heard. And then there are the avoiders. Those who equate God's unconditional love with avoidance of truth. They avoid anything that will cause offense. And so that's a broad category of things. Because today people are offended about almost everything. The Bible says, Proverbs 27, better is open rebuke than hidden love. Brothers and sisters, it says in James chapter 5, if one of you would wander from the truth and someone has the courage to call them out on it, remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their ways will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sin. You can do it. You can speak the truth in love. It's a lonely place. I'm telling you straight up. I wouldn't do it if I were you. It requires too much work. I was in Florida enjoying myself and sweating this presentation and my presentations this afternoon and my message this weekend as well, preaching in another church. And then I also have this thing called a radio broadcast. So I had all this. I had to do another program for my radio. I had to do a presentation here, two presentations this afternoon, preach this weekend. And I got a phone call from a funeral director back in St. Louis who wanted me to do a funeral on Saturday, last Saturday. Now, I wasn't coming back from St. Louis till Sunday. And so my wife and I are sitting there, and I said, I said, can I call you back? I need to pray about this. Because it was a suicide. It was a suicide of a 13-year-old boy. And not only that, I had done the death of his father 6 years previous by suicide. And so the family was leaning on me through the funeral director, and I knew the funeral director well. When you're a big church, you know, you do a lot of funerals, you get to know those guys. And in a big church, you do a lot of awkward things, a lot of awkward conversations, a lot of awkward ministries, weddings and funerals. And you do them in small churches, you just don't do them as often. And I knew what this would be. I knew if it's a suicide of a teenage kid, because I've done them before, I've done car accidents, and probably you have too. And you know there are going to be hundreds of young people there. It's going to be emotional. It had been, because it was the result of bullying in a public school, it had already been covered by two TV stations on nightly news. And my wife was following this, and I just, you know, following it on Facebook, all the stuff going on between this mother who was upset with the school system and calling them out and doing it in the most obnoxious and brutal way that she could, because she was hurt. And the TV stations were there, so there was a lot of chatter back and forth, and I was just, stay out of it. I have enough to do, you know. And so I got this call, and I said, well, let me call you back. Let me pray about this. And right away, Carol says, you have to do this. I said, sweetheart, I don't have the capacity. I can't do one more thing. And she says, well, let's pray about it. And I was sunk then. So she came over and laid her hands on my shoulder. You should do that more often. You should lay hands on people and pray for them. And you just feel the warmth of God's love and his spirit coming through you. And I knew that I had to be there, and despite how difficult. And so we drove back on Friday, and the funeral was 10 o'clock on Saturday, so there wasn't a lot of prep time for that. And in the meanwhile, I started talking to the family, of course, you know, and I talked to the mom and her husband of that kid had committed suicide. She had had another child by somebody else, and she was now living with a third guy. It sounds like the woman at the well, doesn't it? So there's a very dysfunctional family involved here. It wasn't just, you know, bullying. There was a lot of other stuff that was going on here. And I knew I was going to get right in the middle of it. So I'm talking to the mom. And the mom says, now the aunt, and I confirmed this mother when she was 13. And I confirmed her sister, who is now the aunt. And she was going to read the eulogy. And, you know, back in the day, and maybe you've done that, you used to say, well, could I see the eulogy before you say it? And, you know, and then you get into all that, and I just I'm not doing that anymore. I just give them advice. Don't talk only about yourself and your relationship to the person who's died, because, you know, it's not just about you, it's about that person, and you're going to offend everybody else in the room when you just share your own personal memories. And keep it to one page single space, or two pages double space, no more, and write it down, because you're going to lose it when you get up front. So I was okay with that. I don't even need to see it. She's going to say a bunch of stuff that may be wrong, but hey, I have the gospel, I have the pulpit, and it's going to be okay. But then she had another aunt who was going to read a poem. Now, poems tend to speak, you know, this is what I believe to be true. And so I did say, would that be okay? And I said, well, could I see the poem? Would somebody just send it to me? So again, I was out of town. And so they sent me the poem. And the poem basically said two things. It said that Jesus was there when this boy committed suicide. It didn't speak to him directly, but it was a poem about people like that. And it said, and Jesus knew the pain was too great, and so Jesus whispered in his ear, come to me. As though Jesus said, you know, it's okay, kill yourself. I'm right here for you. And then it went on to say, and God chooses only the best to bring home to heaven. just, you know, so I'm dying, you know, that this is going to be read. And I said, I've got to say something, you know, truth and love, you know. I prefer not to, but so let me just, I didn't even know I was going to say this, but this morning it came to me, and I, is that a surprise? So I wrote her, and Carol on this thing said, don't do it. If you're going to let her read it, just, you know, you're only going to upset people. And I said, well, you know, it's a teachable moment. Maybe some people need to be upset or at least think about it. And so this was my response. And, you know, I was typing my response, and somehow my email automatically sent itself. Does that ever happen to you? Like, I only had two lines in. And so I only say that so you understand the first part of this email response to her. I said, I'm sorry for my previous email. I was addressing it when suddenly it sent itself, and before I'd finished saying what I wanted to say. What I was saying in my unedited and unfinished email is your love comes through, and the meaning is well-intentioned, and we can use it just after the eulogy. I would ask that you come up at the same time. I don't like to see parades. I don't like to have dead space in funerals while people walk up or sit down or whatever, and read it immediately after your sister's comments. My concerns are these. I would not suggest that suicide is God's will, as if he was there with Klaus and whispered, come to me. I do believe God was there. I don't believe it's the way somebody dies that either saves them or causes them to be lost. People die of suicide. People die of car accidents. People die of cancer. People die from depression. The question is, where are they in faith? I do believe God was there. This kid and his mom were going to church every Sunday. He was raised in the faith. He was baptized. I don't pretend to know whether he was in faith or not in faith at the time, but I don't think faith or lack of faith was his deciding factor. Come to me. I do believe God was there, or at least his angels, and took Klaus to himself. I believe that, but would not say it was God's intention or even something that he wanted for that boy. And I'm not a fan of the idea that God takes the best for himself. He takes us all, sinner and saint. He makes us all perfect through the forgiveness he provides in Jesus Christ. He doesn't need us in heaven because we make heaven better. I realize that's a poetic concept. Okay, that's just the theologian in me speaking. I do believe that Klaus died in faith, and I have no doubt about his heavenly homecoming. He was actually the same age as one of my granddaughters that went to school together. I know that Klaus loved Christmas, celebrated Easter, and was raised to know Jesus. We aren't saved by what we know or what we don't know. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus. No pastor is any better than any layman. God loves us all. I'm okay with you sharing this, but I did want to express my thoughts to you about the lyrics. I personally believe that God would have wanted Klaus to live a full and loving life with his mama and allowed him to watch her grow up into the fine young man he was becoming. Nevertheless, we are all God's children. Despite our mistakes and confusion, he remains our loving Heavenly Father. God bless. You can weigh in on stuff without agreeing, and you can do it graciously, and you have to. That's your job, as difficult as it is, and as scorned as you might be, or as upset, if this upset her, okay, it upset her. She changed the lyrics. She actually thanked me. She changed the poem. She edited the poem. She thanked me and said, let me change it. I hear what you're saying. So it was a teachable moment for her. She thinks she's a poet, so she's probably going to write more. She's probably going to be asked to speak more, because once you do that, you know, you get invited to other occasions. And I just wanted to have her think about what she's doing. If you do it, okay, I don't like it, and here's why I don't like it, but, you know, go ahead. And so she changed it. I mean, that's the way that turned out. There was another case. I don't want to go too long, but they paid me all this money. I want to be here for them. I want you to get your money's worth. There was another case where we had a homosexual couple, fairly prominent. I didn't know them personally, but I knew their business in the area. I didn't even know they were homosexual. But these two gay men were adopting two sisters, and they were Catholic, strong Catholics, well-known Catholics, and the Catholic Church loved them because they were wealthy and they were prominent. And they were good contributors. But they asked the Catholic Church to baptize these two kids. And the Catholic priest says, can't do that because you're homosexual. You know, and we don't want to be seen condoning that lifestyle. And so they were talking about this with a friend, a member of my church. I don't even know who it was. Said, well, I'll bet our pastor would baptize your kids. And so they picked up the phone and said, you don't know me. You may have known our name. But could I talk to you about baptizing my kids? Didn't say anymore. I didn't know at the time he was homosexual. And I said, sure. My secretary set up an appointment. And so we did. And so that all came out. And I said, here's the deal. I said, absolutely, we'll baptize your kids. You know, because the word of God comes into play. And I love that you respect the power of baptism in your life. I said, but I want you to know that this isn't ex opera operate. You know, that it's not just one thing you do. You need to raise these kids in the Christian faith. Are you going to do that? You're going to raise them in the faith? Because I don't want you to believe that, you know, as long as you get them baptized, as long as you get them buried in the church, then everything's okay. You know, and so I was willing to say that to him. He says, absolutely. He said, could we put them in your school? Because the Catholic Church won't have anything to do with this. I said, oh, gee. I said, because this is going to be a headache. We'd like to have the opportunity to raise your kids in the Christian faith. But please understand this. I'm a conservative Christian pastor. I believe what the scripture has to say about homosexuality, and it doesn't say that that's okay. It says it's wrong. It calls it a sin. It's an aberration. In fact, do you know that in according to statistics of the LGBTQ plus community, only 5% of adult Americans over the age of 18 identify with the LGBTQ. It's an aberration by definition. I mean, there just aren't that many. But if you watch the news and see the shows, you'd believe that, you know, majority of people live that lifestyle. I don't know why I got off the point there, but I'm inclined to do that. So I said, I want you to know that we're not going to teach that that's okay. You know, if your kids are in our school and we get to the question of marriage, if they stay in our school through confirmation, we're going to teach that marriage is a divine appointed blessing between a man and a woman, not between two men. Now, we're not going to embarrass your children. We're not going to call them out. We're not going to speak against you. But neither do I want you to become an activist within my congregation and within my school. You know, I'm not going to embarrass you. You can't embarrass us. And don't make this a deal. And he says, I wouldn't expect anything less from you, Pastor. That's why we're here. And so we reached that agreement, and now I had my whole congregation and my school parents to deal with. We lost a few over that. I had to write a paper about that, you know, that we can be both. You know, we can stand for what's true, and we'll never compromise on this issue in this place, but we will absolutely love, especially kids, and we will teach the truth in love. And I would expect you to do the same. And I have met with these men, and I have their assurance that this isn't going to be an issue, and it never was, never was. You can do this. You can do both. You can stand in the middle. We are called to speak the truth in love. Jesus came as the way, the truth, and the life. Think about that. That's what he said in the upper room the night he left his disciples, went to the Garden of Gethsemane, was arrested. When you think this was the last thing he said to his disciples, wouldn't you think it was pretty important? I mean, this is the last thing he said. He says, and if I go to prepare a place for you, you know I'm going to come back and bring you to where I am. And you know the way. And Thomas, I love Thomas because he speaks his mind. Thomas says, we all know the way. How can we know the way? Jesus said, Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, all three of those things are important, aren't they? I mean, this is what Jesus is. And if we want to be Jesus' representative on earth, we are going to be the way, we are going to be the truth, and we are going to be the life. And don't just assume that because you're a Christian, Christian teacher, Christian leader, Christian youth leader, Christian pastor, don't just assume that you're going to teach the way, because I've been to a lot of churches where the way is not taught. You know, we assume people know that Jesus died for them and that if they believe in him, that they're going to be saved. And so we don't have to go there. That's so simple. Everybody knows that. And so entire messages will be taught. Entire testimonies and preaching will be done, and no mention of Jesus as the way. You know, it, I love the position I have now because I can just be critical. I can just sit out and watch things. And I've been guilty of that myself. You know, just teaching the text. The text doesn't talk about salvation, so I don't talk about salvation. And I was just faithful to the text. I've even defended myself with that argument, that fallacious argument, occasionally. But, you know, I occasionally catch Franklin Graham on TV. Do you do that? With Samaritan's Purse or whatever? And Franklin Graham says the most basic thing, and his daddy did before him, Billy Graham. He said, you know, Jesus is your Lord and Savior. He came to earth for the purpose of bringing you home to be with the Father in heaven. And he loves you so much that he was willing to die for you. And because he died for you, if you believe in him, he's going to bring you back to the Father and all the blessings that are commensurate with being a child of God, including eternal life. You know, every time I hear him say that, I'm never bored with that. I'm always fascinated with that. And I just, you know, from the other side of the pew, from the other side of the pulpit, I just thought, you know, that why do I think that that would bore people? It doesn't bore people. They need to hear that. They need to hear that often. Even pastors need to hear that. And you need to teach that. You need to teach that he is the way. Don't assume that they know that. And don't assume that even if they do know that, that they'll just say, ah, here we go again. They won't. They'll say, man, that's so true. I love that. I love that you say that. Because that's what he is. But he is also the truth. In the book, Man in the Middle, it's told from a story. Todd endorsed the book. I think he's read it. Maybe not. But it's told from the story of a guy who was a beat writer for a newspaper. And he had to cover all these different stories. And so he has some writing ability, but he's a nominal Christian. You know, they don't really go to church anymore, just Christmas and Easter, Christmas and Easter guy. And so he's retiring from his job as a reporter. But his boss doesn't want to let him go because he's developed a bit of a reputation as a writer. And so he says, you know, we're going online with some stuff. Because, you know, nobody's buying print media anymore. He said, so would you write a blog for us, you know, once a month, just once a month? Because we can get national advertising for a blog. With a paper, we can only get local. And we'd like to have your name, and before, you know, while you still have some bit of a reputation, we'd like to use your name. And you can write about whatever you want, just don't be boring. And you can do it from wherever you want. You're retired. I don't care where you spend your time. You can write that from anywhere. And so he's mulling over this opportunity. It would bring extra money in retirement. That's always a good thing. Just like speaking at a conference where you get paid $2,000. So he's mulling it over. And that night, the Lord sends an angel into his house. It's a novel. It could happen. And recruits him to be a modern-day prophet. And he says, I know you've been given this opportunity, and I want you to address the culture from a Christian perspective. He said, Lord, I'm not even a strong Christian. He said, well, there'll be people put in your life, and he runs into people he's not sure if they're angels, and he also has a good Christian friend who's a Bible thumper, and he says, you can talk to him, George, and he'll give you advice, and that's based on some people that I know. And so he has to learn about this. Isn't that the best way? You know, that you have to learn yourself, because when you learn yourself, then you own it, and then you can share out of your own learning. And so I didn't want the book to be top-down. I didn't want it to be authoritarian. I wanted it to be this guy learning himself about these issues and then writing about these issues. And so he deals with all the issues that are issues today about abortion. He ends up writing, and there's 20 different essays in there, 20 different blogs that he writes that are contained in the book. They're set out separately from the narration. But he also learns through his experiences with different people of all different races and kinds. He writes about the racial issue. He writes about R-E-S-P-E-C-T. You know, Aretha Franklin taught the whole world how to spell respect. That can't we respect each other even if we don't agree with each other? Can't we at least have a conversation like I did with Don and Mary and Todd? I think you can. And so that whole book deals with it that way. He comes to believe, and he's always believed, although not necessarily from a Christian perspective, he's always believed that there was right and wrong, good, better, and best. most people do. It's how God has wired people. You know, we have the law of God written on our heart. It won't bring us to salvation, but we have a natural knowledge that things are right, things are wrong, things are good, better, and best. And it's our job to teach those things. Now, I'm not saying that your pulpit should be about that. And even my radio station, my radio program is a commentary. I laid some business cards up here that you can find out, because all my past programs, there's 30 of them out there that I've done already, are available on podcast now after their broadcast. They put them on their website. I put them on Podbean. They're also on what I call the Hour Hour. That's the name of the program. Not my choice. Sounds arrogant to me. But the radio station wanted it to be called that. And so it's also on Facebook under the Hour Hour. You can see all the past programs. And so he writes about cultural issues. And it's a commentary on those issues based on what he learns to be true. And that's what the program is, too. It's not a sermon. It's not intended to be a sermon. I wouldn't preach those things. I'm not asking you to preach these things every week. You know, it's not your job. Your job is to preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified. But don't avoid these things. And when the subject comes up in a text, talk about these things. You know, Barna, in the statistics I was quoting earlier, does say that 90% of the Christian pastors that he's interviewed, thousands, believe that the Bible speaks about the cultural issues that our country's facing today. They believe, 90% of them believe that the Bible speaks those things. 10% of them are willing to talk about them. Only 10%. Why? Because they don't want to offend. They're trying to reach these people. They don't want to offend them. The truth does not offend, folks. You can speak the truth even from the pulpit in a way that's not offensive. You can say, now, I know this is hard for some people, but here's what the Bible says. I'm a person of the Bible, and I know that God loves you no matter what. And even the LGBTQ stuff, it's not the thing that will keep them out of heaven. I believe that there will be homosexual people in heaven, right? What keeps somebody out of heaven is a blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, which is nothing but denial of faith. Now, there are going to be alcoholics in heaven. There are going to be other people with lifestyle sins that are going to be in heaven. But I don't think it's what God wants, and I think the consequence in their life is less than what God prefers for them. And so you can say that to somebody. And you can say, just respect where I'm coming from, and here's what the Bible says, and I can't get around it. And I'm not even going to spell out what those consequences are. I don't know what those consequences are. But I know that's not God's way, and when it's not God's way, it's not going to be under God's favor and God's blessing. And so there's going to be difficulty that you're going to face that I wish you wouldn't have to face. And God doesn't want you to face it either. So there is good, better, and best. There's right and there's wrong. There's truth in the Bible. And you're supposed to be a truth teller. So there's the way. Jesus died for you because he died for you. You're his child. And he wants a relationship with you. Faith is not a religion. It's a relationship. And there's also the life. There's also the life. You know, just mentioned Psalm 37. It's my go-to chapter that talks about don't envy those who seem to get ahead by doing wrong. You know, they're dealing with a lot of stuff that you don't get to see, that they'll never reveal to you. It's not the way that God wants for you. Rather, you know, abide in his truth, and he will bring it to pass. Don't envy those who seem to get away with doing wrong. He came not only that you would have life. He came that you would have life to the fullest. He doesn't only care about your eternal life. He cares about this life. He is the way. He is also the truth. So you want to know what's true about what's going on in the country? God has a lot to say about, you know, what's true, what's good, better, and best. He also has a lot to say about me personally and what will lead to a better life for me. You know, if you're dealing with an issue, whether it's your, you know, router or your TV, your smart TV, all the stuff that we deal with, you know, when in doubt, what do? You consult the manual, right? You should, or maybe Google it. You go to somebody who knows. And when you want to know what's best about life, go to the one who knows. Go to the one who designed it. And that's God. And these are the things that he will bless. These are the things that he will not bless. If your children are stealing from the store, are you going to say, good job, man. Next time, could you get maybe some of this? No, you're not going to say that. You're going to say, that ain't right, child, because I love you. I remember when I was a kid, we were down the street, two doors down. The Thrashers had a little bit of acreage, and we'd go down there, and we could play football or whatever, and it was a rainy day, and there was mud everywhere. And so we got to throwing mud at each other and sliding in the mud and started throwing mud at each other and at cars that would come by. Seemed like the right thing to do. And man, I don't know who squealed, but somebody told my mom. And she came down with a yardstick, and that was a long walk home. There were other kids. I said, what about the Sorensen kids, you know? What about the Lewises? They are not my kids, you know? But I was, and because she loved me, she's gonna discipline me. You know, the ones that we love, we speak truth to. You know, there's a right way and there's a wrong way to live life. And she wanted to make sure I knew what was right and I was wrong. C.F.W. Walter called it long gospel, you know. And if you don't teach the law, people lose appreciation for the gospel, right? Isn't that true? There's somewhere in my notes here, I mentioned the story of Jesus when he went to the house of Simon. You remember the Pharisee? I think that was a total setup. Simon invited him for dinner, and he had all of his elite friends there. And I'm surprised that Jesus went, because we know from the interaction, the social interaction, that Simon was setting him up. You know, because Jesus later says, when I came into your house, you didn't even give me water to wash my feet. You know, this woman has cried and washed my feet with her tears. You didn't give me oil to anoint my head. You know, this woman has anointed my feet with perfume. You didn't greet me with a kiss. This woman has not stopped kissing my feet. So that's why I believe that Simon was, you know, going to be a bully there. He was going to embarrass Jesus by letting this sinful woman did just stroll into his house, let me tell you. You know, he had security. And so he allows this to happen. And Jesus says, let me tell you a story, Simon. Can I tell you a story? Simon says, tell away. He says, there was a man who was a lender, and there was somebody who owed him 50 denarii, and there was someone who owed him 500 denarii. And he said, and the man realized that neither one of them had the means to repay him. You know, we're all broke. He says, and so he forgave them both. Who do you think loved him more? And Simon, being the wise man that he said, of course, the guy who owed him more probably loved him more. He said, you have answered correctly. If you have been forgiven little, you love little. If you've been forgiven much, you love much. If people don't think they're sinners, if people don't realize the depth of their being apart from God's will in their life, they will lose appreciation for the gospel. But when they know that we're all fall short, that, you know, that we have a huge debt that we can never repay, and God has forgiven that because of Jesus, man, he would do that for me. He would love me that much. So if you're not preaching the law, then you're not preaching the gospel very effectively. You may think you are. You know, you're out there welcoming everybody that you can and saying God loves you, but it has no depth to it because they don't need God's love. Why do they need God's love? They can handle things quite well on their own because they're not all that bad. They just have chosen a different path. It's a wrong path. You know that. They don't. And you're not calling it out. So they'll lose appreciation for what God has done for them in Christ Jesus. So that's the deal. You know, there's a clear parallel between the battle for the Bible and the battle against the culture today. The issue is the impact of the woke culture on the Christian church in America and around the world. You hear a lot about the woke culture today. I'm late to the game, day late, dollar short. But I'm always curious. You know, you could kind of hear the word and understand what it means. You know, somehow I'm aware, I'm awoke, you know, I realize the complexity of issues. But I did some research. Did I tell you I do a radio program? So, you know, I'm always looking for material. And evidently that term grew out of the black culture in America. Culture experts trace its origins to something called the African American Vernacular English. That's a mouthful. The African American Vernacular English. I didn't even know there was such a thing. I'm not a fan of racial distinctions in America. I prefer to think of all of us as American. And so that would be American slang, just street language. That's what I would call it. I wouldn't call it an African American term. I don't believe that we're black Americans, Asian Americans, Hispanic American, Puerto Rican, Haitian. We're just American. But woke was added to the dictionary in 2017. It's defined this way: being alert to social issues, racism and discrimination and injustice. Two thumbs up. Don't we all want that? Don't we all want to be alert to those things? So that's another thing. I want to say that on both extremes, there's things that we can learn. You know, I learned from those people, you know, who were higher critical and the way they were gracious. You know, I tried to take that from them. And I learned from the people who said, this is what the scripture says, we can't compromise that. I want to take that from them. So I'm not saying abandon both their houses. I'm saying learn from both of their houses. You know, even woke churches today, I think I can learn from them. Because churches that are just banging away on these things, they're not helping people. And it is important that we be inclusive and welcome people, but we shouldn't just leave them there. You know, remember when the woman who was caught in the very act of adultery was thrown at Jesus' feet? Jesus knelt down and begun to write in the sand. We don't know what he wrote. We can guess. But whatever it was, it convicted the people that were ready to stone her. And they started walking away. And it's kind of an interesting little tidbit. But it said first the old people and then the younger guys, you know. The old people who realized they were old enough to realize they weren't perfect. And so they dropped their stones and walked away. And then the younger people who were more idealistic, they said, wow, I guess we should walk away too. And then Jesus turned to the woman and says, where are those who convict you, who were going to stone you? And she says, I don't see them, Lord. They have left. He says, neither do I convict you. And then he said, go and sin no more. You know, you got yourself in this mess. You know, what you're doing is not working out for you. You know it, I know it, everybody knows it. Go and sin no more. Clean up your act, lady. I mean, he cared enough to say, yeah, you're forgiven, I accept you, but I don't endorse what you're doing. I'm not saying it's okay. It's not okay. It's hurtful. It's hurtful to you, it's hurtful to your witness, and it's hurtful to people that you love. And so we should be accepting, and we should be welcoming, but we should care enough to teach that which is true. So the woke thing quickly became associated with left-wing politics, social liberal causes, feminism, LGBTQ, activism, racial equality, or I should say racial equity. There's a difference between equity and equality. I did a whole broadcast on that. Equity is same outcomes. Equality is same opportunity. Huge difference. Let me just say that I do believe in white privilege. I do think there's a benefit to the fact that I'm white. And even though I was raised poor, very poor, we had an outhouse my whole growing up. We didn't have indoor plumbing until after they got rid of me, and then they got that. So I grew up poor, but still, racially, I have advantages when I show up for something. I had a vicar one time, Paul Wong, in Texas, and that was after Vietnam, and they were reorienting a lot of Vietnamese to our country, and because Paul was actually from Taiwan, he was Chinese, he was not Vietnamese, but the rednecks in Texas don't know the difference. And I remember one time going into a store with him, he needed something for a computer or whatever. And I remember walking into the store with him, and the man looked right over him. I wasn't there, I was just there as his friend. The man looked right over him and said, can I help you, sir? And I said, well, Paul here needs something. He goes, he can wait. So I do believe that there's white privilege. So I know that there's advantage to being white, so I'm not denying that. I believe there's also athletic privilege. You know, there are people who are born with athletic ability that I don't have. There's musical privilege. There's educational privilege. There's all kinds of other privileges. I don't think there's anything that the government can do or that I can do to make equal outcomes. unless they lower the basket for me and make everybody else shoot at 10 feet. You know, so there's inequality in the world. That's just the way it is. Now, we should be compassionate towards those who are being abused, just like with Paul. You know, I said, hey, that isn't right. And we should speak up for folks like that. But we can never just make everything equitable. We can never make inequality go away. We just have to deal with the inequality as we face it. So we have to provide equal opportunity and make sure that when people are abused because of prejudice, that we step up and step in. Under the ban of tolerance and social justice, the woke advocates began attacking anyone who held different views. And so they silenced us. You're racist, you're homophobic, you're sexist, you're transphobic, you're xenophobic. I don't know if you've read it, but Candace Owens wrote a book. Do you know who Candace is? She's a prominent young black lady who has a conservative point of view, and she thinks that that will be more helpful in the black culture than welfare and wokeness. She wrote in her book, Blackout, to be clear, the belief that white people are to assume all responsibility for black America's shortcomings is a form of white power. One must believe in black inferiority to accept the thesis that black America is not responsible for any of its own shortcomings in a free society. You're not really helping them, you know, by saying it's somebody else's fault. Conservatives believe neither in white power or black inferiority, which is why we routinely reject the narrative that the white man is to blame for all the problems of our culture. There's a lot of good about being woke, and I think you should always say that. You should always say, so what? Why is that so attractive to people? What is there that appeals to people? Because, you know, you want to learn from that. And I used to say, and I would use pop music occasionally in church. And at first that was a bit shocking. It was probably more shocking when we brought drums out on the stage for the first time, or when I took my robes off. You know, there's these little cultural things in the Lutheran church that you shouldn't do. And if you forget them, the congregation will slap you and remind you of those things. I remember there's a lady I loved who was, and her husband was sick, and I went to visit them in her home a lot, and he eventually died. I even held her funeral later, but she would always sit up front, but man, she hated the drums on the stage. And so I would greet people, like I came out and greeted people here before service began, and she had paper in her hand, and she was hiding it. And I said, what do you have there, Eleanor? She goes, oh, nothing. I said, well, it's something. I said, you're talking to people. She goes, well, I have a petition. I'm petitioning people in the congregation to get rid of the drums on the stage. And she goes, and some of your elders have signed it. I said, well, good luck with that, Eleanor. I'm not, this isn't high school. I'm not your principal. You know, we're gonna do what seems best. We're going to be outwardly focused in this congregation. We're going to be biblically faithful because we're not going to compromise God's word. And we're going to be culturally relevant. We're going to be all three of those things because that's where the power is. And it'll be up to the congregation to decide these things. It won't be because you write a petition, but I love you. It never ended our relationship. We got on just fine. But there's a lot of good about being woke. We should listen to others who have a different perspective than we do. Yeah. I didn't grow up as they grew up. We should be aware of their struggles. No matter where you fall on the social ladder, there are always going to be those who are below you and those who are above you. In my book, Man in the Middle, Jim, who writes the article on racism, says, I never heard any racist comments in our home or from the sizable contingent of Caucasian aunts, uncles, and church friends that were always around. It was more of a live and let live, albeit segregated kind of understanding. That's the 50s and 60s, mostly 60s. It was more of a live and let live, albeit segregated kind of understanding on both sides of the racial question. There were no whites only drinking fountains or restrooms, no white only signs anywhere in my hometown that I recall. It was more of a culture of segregation by racial choice. I grew up assuming segregation was a standard operating procedure on both sides of the color divide in the 1960s. We knew it was not right, but neither was it intentionally evil at its root. But the woke culture goes beyond that. It doesn't just say, you know, you ought to be understanding, you ought to be accepting, you ought to realize there's prejudice in the world. Of course we should. Of course we should want equality. But if you study that culture further, they go past that. They want to dissolve the concept of the nuclear family, abolish capitalism, eliminate religion, rewrite the Constitution, cancel movies, cartoon characters, sports teams' names and mascots, defund law enforcement, allow open borders, guarantee income, open all prisons and have no bail bonds, refuse to prosecute crimes because they disadvantage the minorities. Some contend that gender binary roles of men and women are merely a social construct, despite the fact that he made them male and female. Now let me just say that in the chapter on gender in there, I realize that not every gender confused issue is a matter of moral choice. There are biological issues. Men typically, before the fall, because I think after the fall things changed. Before the fall, you know, men had XY chromosomes and women had XX chromosomes. But do you know today, because of our advanced science, there are men who have XX chromosomes and higher estrogen than their gender, than their physicality, than their genitalia, would lead you to expect. So it's not always a moral choice for people. You know, they do, and there's something, if you study it further, the testosterone that's caused by the XY chromosome washes through a baby's inner uterine. It also washes through the baby's brain again at about age 13 when they go through puberty. And it causes male characteristics. It causes male thinking. But if they don't have the XY chromosome, if they have an XX chromosome, they're going to be influenced by different levels of by estrogen instead of testosterone. And so there are biological reasons why some people identify, even though they have male genitalia, they're going to identify with a female way of thinking. It's not all moral. You should know this. And it causes you to be more gracious. It doesn't make it right. You know, God's word is still true on these issues, but it should make us more compassionate and more understanding of what causes some of these things. It's not black and white. There's gray in the world. Now, before the fall, there was black and there was white. But since sin came into the world, it changed. You know, weeds grow. There's birth defects. There's all kinds of, there's cancer. There's things in the world that aren't right now. And we as Christians should be compassionate and understanding of those things. But it doesn't mean that we can still say, well, you know, I realize that you're a unique circumstance. You know, God's word is not black and white on that issue. It is black and white on that issue, and it's not gray, and we should still speak the truth in love. Even advocates of wokeism realize there's danger in this. Barack Obama, at a conference, his own conference held in Chicago in 2019, said, the idea of purity, that you're never compromised and that you're always politically woke and all that stuff, you should get over that pretty quickly. The world is a messy place. Amen? I was just talking to somebody before that we began today. He said, life is good. I said, but even when life is good, life is hard, right? You know, it's just never easy. You know, and that's why he's put you here, to help with all that, to help deal with some of the confusion, some of the hardness. So Barack says the world is messy. He said this at his conference. There are ambiguities. People who do really good stuff have flaws. Amen? There is this sense of sometimes the way of making change is to be as judgmental as possible about other people, and that's enough. Like if I tweet or hashtag about how you didn't do something right or used a wrong verb, then I can sit back and feel pretty good about myself because, man, you see how woke I was? I called you out. I'm going to get on TV, watch my show. Watch Grownish. You know, that's not activism, Barack said. That's not bringing about change. If all you're doing is casting stones, you're probably not going to get much done. Well, he was heavily criticized, surprise, surprise, by the activist community for saying that. One of the most prominent in his criticism said, I'm never quite sure what Obama thinks. This naivete Is it naivete, or is he trying to convince certain segments of the population, notably young black folk, whom he just loves to lecture, that it's better to coddle white people about their prejudice with the hopes that growth rather than speak our minds as we see fit? In fact, it had ramifications. They were about to rename a high school in Chicago that was named Thomas Jefferson Lutheran High, and they were going to name it Barack Obama High in honor of the first black president. And man, they came out against it strongly, especially the Hispanic community, because he deported more Hispanic people back to Mexico than any other president before him, or probably after him. And this is what appeared in the Chicago Tribune. From the time Barack became president until 2017, when he left, his administration is responsible for the greatest number of deportations of any president. If we are removing the name of Thomas Jefferson, one oppressor, the name of Barack Obama is another oppressor, and our people won't stand for it. So, you know, they begin to eat their own after a while. You know, even extremists can see the danger in extreme. The woke culture has found its way into the American church. And you can quote passage after passage of inclusion and acceptance, and most pastors do, and rightfully so, because God extends his hand to everyone. In fact, I love that passage in Romans chapter 10 that says, all day long I have held out my hand to an obstinate and disobedient people. He still does that for you. He still does that for me. When I'm wrong, he's still holding his hand out. He still loves me. Doesn't agree with me, but he still holds out his hand to an obstinate and disobedient people. I could quote you from 1 Timothy chapter 2. God our Savior Jesus desires all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Man, that is so true. Or Matthew 11. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. I don't care what your laden is. I don't care if it's a gender issue. I don't care if it's a sexual orientation issue. I don't care if it's a racial issue. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me. I'm gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest, the rest that you need. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed, for there's no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all. So there's a lot of inclusive passages that we should hold out. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, I'm determined to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. And that is the primary message that we should teach, that our pulpits and our classrooms should come to understand. But the Bible also says it's not the whole truth. You know who Sam Nafsker is? Some of you older folk will. No, he was the head of commission on church theology, CTCR, Church Theology and Church Relations, the Commission on Church Theology and whatever the numbers mean, CTCR. Sam was a good friend. I've known Sam a long time. I know Joel Leyenbauer well as well. His wife was on our staff. And Sam said, I used to believe that heresy was teaching that which is wrong. Heresy is teaching that which is wrong. I now believe that heresy is mostly teaching that which is partly true out of context. I've never forgot that. You should write that down. It's not me who said it. Sam who said it. And then the passage about Simon, you know, he who is forgiven little loves little. He who is forgiven much loves much is Luke chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said a good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter on that day. I will say to some, I never knew you, depart from me. See, I don't believe that these sins necessarily, even though there are passages, and I've got them written here, but we're running out of time, Galatians 5, 1 Corinthians 6, Romans 13, they all list homosexuality or different sins as leading, as putting you out of the kingdom of God. I believe they're dangerous. I think lifestyle sins are more dangerous than some sins. They're just an action because they become a way of thinking. They become a way of life. It's not the sin itself that can lead to eternal death. It's what the sin does. Because the pastor is going to speak against something that makes me uncomfortable, I'm not going to listen to that pastor. Or because the Bible says things I don't want to hear, I'm not going to read the Bible. And because the Savior stands for these things, I'm not going to follow that Savior. So these are things that could lead people away from salvation. That's the danger in them. It's not the sin itself. And I think it helps me to have that clear in my mind. This sin doesn't mean that you're going to hell. This sin means that your life is going to be harder than it needs to be. And the danger is that you'll begin to defend this thing. And you'll speak against everything that challenges your thinking. And therein lies the danger when you begin to defend that which is wrong. And that can lead you to eternal death. That's my concern. James chapter 2, you know, it says, someone may well say, you have faith, I have works. Show me your faith without works, and I will show you my faith by what I do. You believe that God is one, you do well to believe that. The devil also believes that. Or 2 Peter chapter 1, wow, what a powerful chapter that is, 2 Peter chapter 1. God's divine power has granted us everything pertaining to life and godliness. And through the knowledge of him who called us, we're passive, he's active, the one who called us by his own glory and his excellence has granted us the precious, magnificent promises. So now I make this appeal to you that you should add to your faith moral excellence, and to your moral excellence knowledge, and to your knowledge self-control, and to your self-control perseverance, and to your perseverance godliness, and to your godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, you need to possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being unproductive and ineffective in your knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Notice they won't make you more effective, they won't make you more efficient, but they will keep you from being ineffective. You know, if you don't have these qualities, if you don't care for what is true, if you don't care for what is morally excellent, you will become ineffective and unproductive. And I would say that is one of the leading causes. I didn't get to that whole section. I got more to do here. But I know there are reasons, you know, why people have quit coming to church. Jesus predicted that in the last days. He said, you know, people's hearts will grow old. I'll be surprised if I find any still believing when I come. That's straight from Jesus' predictions about end times. And we're closer to the end times now than he was. So Matthew 24 says, you know, that's going to happen. There are other reasons, no doubt. The breakup of the nuclear family, militant secularism, the lack of spiritual authenticity among Christians, the abandonment of morality, even in the church. The church doesn't deal with moral issues anymore. Intellectual skepticism, you know, our universities and colleges and even high schools now teach that which is wrong. There's a rise of atheism and the normal defiant posture of young people. But I believe that these explanations for why people are straying from the faith and no longer attending church are symptoms. They are not the cause. I believe the church has lost its voice. They come expecting to hear the voice. They come expecting to hear the truth, even if it bothers you. And I've heard many a sermon that bothered me. I heard one last week, you know, about my failings and my flaws. And it caused me to come to repentance and then receive the Lord's Supper afterward with greater appreciation. You know, so many messages today, and I've seen pastors do it, they take a popular book or they take a popular subject and they try to help people with their life using the book, the Bible, as a counseling guide to life. And it's that, you know, it's helpful in that way, but it's so much more. It's intended to be so much more. You know, we tend to blame the media. The media is not speaking out about these things that are culturally wrong. And if they were being more honest about it, it'd be a better place. But I think the pulpit's not talking about these things. Christian friends are not talking about these things. I demonstrated with Don and Mary and Todd, you can talk about these things. There's a voice in your head that says you shouldn't talk about these things. You'll risk a relationship. I don't think you will. I think you'll deepen a relationship. You know, when I was in St. Louis full-time, I attended and it was mostly a Jewish golf club, and they were dying, and so they wanted to be more inclusive, and so they welcomed some prominent Christian pastors to join. They waived my initiation dues, which were like $20,000, and then they only charged me half of the member dues. I said, well, man, to play on that course, sign me up. And so I came there, and the pro, believe it or not, actually had a fish symbol on his golf bag, and was a Christian person. And he would say, you need to come alongside Bill out there on the driving range. His wife's going through cancer. And he could use a word of hope, word of encouragement. And so he and I kind of worked together to evangelize the club. And, you know, if I ever came up to somebody even that I knew was Jewish, I would ask them questions, and they would ask me questions, and I'd have an opportunity to spend the gospel. But I'd also say, can I pray for you? Never did one person say no. They welcomed my prayers. You have the opportunity to still have a voice. I don't ask you to be a truth teller, to bang on people. I don't ask you to be an avoider. I ask you to speak the truth in love. There's huge pressure for you to conform, especially in the Missouri Synod. Man, it's a church of conformity. And if you don't even conform with traditions, you'll get banged on. But if you don't conform with theology, and positions, even more so. You know, we're called to be the way, the truth, and the life. Let me just finish with this. When I first started out my ministry, the passage that was a guiding passage for me was Joshua 1:7. Todd remembers it was even my AOL account. William and Lori know that too. Joshua 1:7 was my AOL account. Be strong and courageous. Do not turn from the right or to the left of all that I've commanded you, and you will have success wherever you go. It's the only place in the Bible where success is mentioned. It's interesting that David also quotes this to Solomon when he's about to die on his deathbed. Same thing. Says the same thing. But later in my ministry, it was out of insecurity that I was trying to always be strong and courageous. And I'm less insecure now. I still have some insecurity. You make me nervous to be here. But my passage today is Zechariah 4, verse 6. Not by power and not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Isaiah 55. My word is become with it, will not be bound, but will have free course. It will not return to me void without accomplishing. Like the rain and snow, it will not return to me without accomplishing the purpose for which I sent it. So know that. Know that there is such a thing as self-evident truth. That when you speak the truth, people resonate to it because they know it's true. Don't be afraid. You're not alone. As the sign says, you're not alone. You know, God is with you, and his word has power. Amen. Thanks for being here. You've been gracious. My cards are here. You're welcome. And you can pick up any one of these books if you want for $10 today. So there's a brown envelope that has change in it if you need change. You're on the honor system.